one of the most, maybe the most charismatic chess player in history. Fischer is also an example of what we should never do with children who have a big talent for something, for chess or whatever it is, which is to allow them to become obsessed, in this case with chess. What we must do is to make sure they got a balanced education, a high quality education. Because, you know, Fischer was a genius. And although I cannot demonstrate scientifically something which has been published in several biographies saying that his IQ was higher than Einstein's one, but I think that's true. According to my talks to him, I think he was really a genius, not only for chess. But, you know, the borderline between genius and madness is a very thin one. So, a well-educated genius can be in the good side. For instance, Magnus Carlsen. But a bad, very badly educated genius can go to the bad side. For instance, Bobby Fischer. And, well, this is about what I want to talk today. If you say chess is a very good school for life, that's perfect, because it is true. You can learn a lot of things from chess which are very helpful in your daily life. If you say, I can say that for instance, chess is a very important part of my life, this is also fine. Karpov said, chess is my life. Korchnoi also said, chess is my life. But Fischer says something different. He said, chess is life, in the meaning that my life is only chess. Actually, his life was not 100% chess. When he was a teenager, remember he liked basketball and some movies, some TV, but his social life was very poor indeed. He went to the school, actually to more than 6 or 7 different schools, because he was expelled from three of them. Actually he was there, but he wasn't there. He was always thinking about chess, or playing chess with his pocket board. And the teachers made a kind of agreement with him. Okay, Bobby, we cannot stop you to play chess or to think about chess all the time, but please, don't take out your pocket chess board, because then that will be a very bad example to the other pupils. And then what they were doing, the teachers, by saying that, was stimulating him to play blindfold chess, which is what he was doing during the classes for years. So he went to school, but actually he wasn't there. And another problem is that he spent a lot of time alone at home after school, because his mother, we are talking now in a few minutes more in deep about Regina, but his mother had several jobs, so she was coming home late in the evening. And his daughter, his sister, Joan, was coming home later than him as well. So a lot of hours alone at home, just playing chess. She studied medicine in Moscow. So she had some communist ideas. She was born in Switzerland. She was Jewish. Parents were Polish and Russian. Then she moved to Germany. then to Moscow. Then when Stalin took power, she moved to Paris. Then to Chicago with Joan. In Chicago is where Bobby was born. Then to Arizona, to a very small village in Arizona. Then to New York, Manhattan first, and Brooklyn later. According to the FBI files, which are very interesting, we know some things about Regina. She was very intelligent, very nervous, hyperactive. She was an activist, politically activist, communist, and she got several jobs as a teacher, as a nurse, then she got a degree on nursing, and so on. Well, it is important to know how the mother was in order to understand how Bobby was. But you know, most important, more important even is this one. The real father of Fischer was not Gerard Fischer, as the official documents say for many years. It was Paul Nemenyi, a very prominent Hungarian physicist, very intelligent one as well, which is important to underline. Paul Nemenyi died in 1952, when Bobby was 9 years old. During his last 2 years of life, Paul was visiting Bobby and Regina and Joan in Manhattan, and taking Bobby to have dinner and things like that. He was even paying a monthly money to help to Bobby's education and so on. But, and this is a very important but, Bobby never knew that Paul was his father. He thought that he was his mother's friend until he died. When he died, Regina told Bobby, "Paul was your father." Can you imagine how traumatic can that be?
Did Paul know that Bobby was his son?
Sorry?
Did Paul know that Bobby was his son?
Oh yes, of course. Yeah, yeah. That's why he was paying a monthly stipend and so on. Yeah, yeah. Actually, there are some statements from social workers and people who were talking to Paul frequently, and one of them said one day Paul broke in tears because he was very concerned about the bad education Bobby was getting from Regina, which is also significant, I think. I think this is important to stress because, well, probably all of you know what chess was in the Soviet Union. Just a few figures to summary up. The Soviet Union had 287 million inhabitants. 5 million of them were registered chess players, and 50 million were playing chess frequently, let's say, in an amateur way. Just playing tournaments inside the Soviet Union was also forbidden. Writing chess articles was forbidden. Giving chess lectures was forbidden. Making TV chess programs was forbidden. And my monthly salary as a grandmaster was taken out. But Taimanov was also a brilliant pianist. And everything I said about chess was done also about music. So everything was forbidden for him. Then I remember Taimanov, I quote more or less him telling me, "You know, I was very lucky because a few months later, in the semifinals, Fischer 6 Larsen, zero. Larsen was an extremely strong Danish grandmaster, another one of the world top. And then Taimanov told me, you know, probably somebody at the Kremlin, the Soviet government, thought, well, something strange is going on here. Because when I lost to Fischer, they were convinced that it was on purpose. I mean, that it was a prearranged match, and because they couldn't believe that I could lose 6-0. Then, when a Danish grandmaster does the same, then somebody at the Kremlin thought, well, that's impossible. Cannot be prearranged. I mean, both matches prearranged, that's too much. So I recovered a little bit of my privileges. I got my salary again, and so on. Of course, he couldn't travel abroad for 2 years or something like that, but, well, that was the effect of the Fischer phenomenon in the Soviet Union. I want more money. Then two very interesting things happened. First, a London millionaire, Jim Slater, doubles the prize fund, gives another 125,000, making 250,000 altogether. And the other thing is, this man, Henry Kissinger, a kind of foreign affairs minister at the USA, calls Bobby and says more or less, I'm calling you on behalf of President Nixon in order to ask you a very patriotic task. You should go to Reykjavik and you should defeat Spassky, because for our country, it's extremely important to humiliate the Soviets on a chessboard in terms of political propaganda and so on. So the President Nixon and myself, we kindly ask you to go to Reykjavik and beat Spassky. To be sincere, I have no idea about what was more influential, this call from Mr. Kissinger or the $125,000 extra given by Jim Slater. But it is true that Fischer went to Reykjavik. Big scandals there. Of course, I had to fulfill my duties as an arbiter. We are talking about a world championship final with a lot of popularity all over the world. But at the same time, I was feeling to destroy a genius, because if I disqualify Fischer, probably he will be unable to recover himself from that big tragedy. So, well, I think it is worth to mention how Mr. Schmidt was suffering at that moment. Okay, Fischer won, and his contribution was already fantastic. And then she made a proposal to the Soviet government. He said, okay, let me move to Paris with her, and in exchange of that, I promise I will never make any statement against the Soviet Union, and I'll be always available to play for the national team. They accepted, which was surprising, but they accepted and they allowed him to go to Paris. Okay, but then the Kremlin needs a new national hero capable to recover the national honor lost by Spassky. They choose Anatoly Karpov. And the choosing was a very right one, because Karpov won practically everything to become the challenger, a man from Venezuela called Isidoro Cherem. He was one of the very few real friends of Fischer. He was helping him a lot with money and many other things. Then Cherem advised me to hide that I was a journalist. And he said, at least at the beginning, don't tell Bobby that you are a journalist because he hates the journalists. But I wasn't feeling comfortable with that idea, and I decided to tell the truth. And I said, I was a, let's say, semi-professional chess player for 10 years, and then I became a journalist. I'm a specialist in chess, and I'm trying to promote chess as a journalist. Okay, that was more or less fine for 1 or 2 years. And then we are in about Christmas 1990. I am in Lyon, in France, covering the fifth and last match Karpov-Kasparov. And at home, in the Basque country, my home telephone rings, and my wife is answering, and then she was very impressed with somebody says, "Hello, I am Bobby Fischer." And, well, he asked for Leontxo, and then my wife says, well, he is in Lyon covering the World Championship match. And he reacts very strongly, saying, "What? The World Championship match? These crooks of Karpov and Kasparov, they have pre-arranged all their games. Why is your husband there? Those are imposters." Well, my wife said, well, he is doing his job. He is covering the match for the newspaper El País, for the Spanish radio, for the Spanish TV, and so on. "Ah, this is disgusting. Your husband shouldn't contribute to these crooks," and so on. Okay, let him know that Bobby Fischer has called him. Okay, at that moment, one businessman from Barcelona, José Ignacio Borés, had the idea of making a proposal to Fischer to play a match, let's call a friendly match with Spassky. That means 18 years after the Reykjavik match, 1990. Then a meeting was organized at the Hyatt Hotel near the Frankfurt airport. It was, I think it was March 1991. March 1991. Then I meet Fischer at the reception hall. And at the beginning, he's correct. He's polite with me, but nothing more than polite, okay? By the way, let me tell you, no, I will tell you later. Just polite. Then we go for lunch, the four of us, Cherem, Borés, Bobby, and myself. And I was sitting down in front of Bobby. We got a soup, a starter. And after the soup, he takes his pocket chessboard out. He makes a position there, and he passes the pocket chessboard to me. And he says, "Is this position something special for you?" The position was, let me see if I can show you. This one. And I was very lucky because as a chess player myself, I was a, let's call it, a specialist in the four pawns attack against the King's Indian. And I said, "Yes, this is your game with the Spanish Grandmaster Arturo Pomar, a Havana Olympiad 1966. And here you sacrificed, a very nice move, this c4, because if white takes in on c4, black can take on e4, because then the line over the white king is open, and so on." And then Pomar played bishop f3, and after castle you played b5, because this pawn cannot be taken because of the check of the queen here, and so on. Then, after that, his attitude to me changed dramatically, because that was a test to check if I was a former chess player who became a journalist, or if I was cheating him. So then he became to be very kind. We talk about a lot of things and so on. But this evening after dinner, we were alone. And I want to tell you something. At that moment, at that period of his life, he was in very bad companies. He was very often with, do you say in English, philo-Nazis? I mean, somebody who has an ideology close to the Nazis, okay? Fascist or whatever, something like this. He was very close to this kind of people. And after dinner, we were just walking across the old part of Frankfurt. And then suddenly I discovered the worst part of Fischer's character. I discovered he hated women in general. He hated black people. He hated communists, of course. He hated Jews, having in mind that his mother and his father were Jewish. Of course, he hated journalists as well. Then it was a terrible shock for me. You know, normally I am very lucky because when I went to bed, I only need just 5 minutes to be slept. But that night, it took maybe 5 hours instead of 5 minutes. Because the very same day I was able to meet my idol, that very same day, few hours later, I was discovering the terrible part of my idol's character. This time, I'm going there with Mr. Rentero, the creator of the Linares tournament, whom, by the way, passed away just 1 month ago. And the idea was the same. As Fischer was asking too much money to Borés, the Barcelona businessman, then Rentero had a new offer for Bobby. We went to Los Angeles, and there the most interesting thing to tell you is, well, two things. We had lunch alone, Bobby and myself. And it was a very interesting lunch. One of the talks was about his visit, his travel to the Komodo Island in Indonesia, which is one of the two only places in the world where you can still see dragons alive. And his way of talking about that, you know, made me feel that I was having lunch with my son, who at that moment was 4 years old, instead of with Bobby Fischer, because of his way of explaining things. He was like a big child. Then after lunch, he asked me, okay, Leontxo, do you like walking? And I said, yes, of course, I like very much walking. And he said, but I mean walking quickly, fast. And I said, yes, no problem. But I mean walking fast and for a lot of time. I said, yeah, Bobby, don't worry. We can go walking together. And then it was about a 3 hour walk. A lot of very interesting things. You know, when we were talking, for instance, about international politics, if the Jewish were not coming to the conversation, his way of thinking and talking was extremely interesting. On that moment, I remember myself thinking, well, he is really a genius. His analysis on international politics and so on were really brilliant sometimes. But in other moments, for instance, he told me that Jan Tiemann, the very famous Dutch grandmaster, was a KGB agent. But that wasn't the worst. Few minutes later, he told me that Korsnoy was a KGB agent as well. I said, well, Bobby, this is just impossible. Please stop saying these kind of things. But he got really angry and so on. Anyway, 3 hours after the beginning of that walking, suddenly he says, okay, let's stop for a moment here. Leontxo, now I have to ask you a little favor. I said, okay, tell me, Bobby. You see, there is a bus stop there, about maybe 150 meters from here. And I don't want you to know the bus number I'm going to take to go home. So please come back to the hotel by your own. I say, okay, of course, no problem. I will look for some taxi stop and that will be the solution. But I think it's also a significant anecdote about his way of thinking and about his illness, actually. At that moment, it was Yugoslavia. Finally, somebody managed to persuade him about coming back to chess and to play a match with Spassky, but that was during the Yugoslavia war, which means that Fischer was violating the UN embargo against Yugoslavia. We were just 50 kilometers away from the war, and many very prominent media like New York Times, Washington Post, ABC, BBC, etc., called their special war correspondents and say, stop covering the war for a couple of days and go to Sveti Stefan to cover Fischer's first press conference in 20 years. That was the Bobby Fischer's popularity, okay? Well, after that, he won, of course, but he was threatened by the USA justice. And he became again a clandestine winner. He spent some time in Budapest, living at Polgar's family home. You know, Polgar's family, well, they are Jewish. And Judith and Susan told me several times that Bobby very often was talking against the Jews, being a guest of the Polgar's family. Well, finally, he got arrested at the Tokyo airport, I think it was 2004. And he said, well, yes, but I know that you know him. Yes, that's true, but that's not a guarantee of me coming back here with an interview with Fischer. He said, don't worry, if you don't get the interview, you know so much about him, you can interview people there who is in contact with him, and you can make a no-interview story, which could be very interesting as well. And that was the case. I went there, I spoke to one of his very few friends at that moment, Grandmaster Helgi Olafsson, and I gave a note, a message for Bobby, and he came back, Olafsson came back next day saying, Bobby has nice memories on you, and about the interview he said, he wants to think about it, so just wait. I was waiting for 4 days, but nothing happens. Then, the next day, at 4 o'clock in the morning, I took the bus to go to the airport. And during the journey to the airport, I thought, oh, well, I realized that Bobby actually was making me a favor by refusing the interview. Because if I have to interview him seriously in a professional way, I have to ask him about why you hate black people, women, communists, Jewish, why are you so happy about September 11th, and so on. And that will be terrible for me. I will feel really horrible if I have to do this. So by refusing that interview, I think he was right. And, you know, he died at 64, 1 year for each square. And I have another piece of video. I hope I will be able to find out the exact moment, because I think it's a very interesting one. It's an Icelandic neurologist who was in touch with Bobby very often in Reykjavik.
To disprove anything he said.
I met Bobby after he came to Iceland. His existence was a very long one. He gradually, in Iceland, like everywhere else, he alienated people with his behavior. We just walked around the pond downtown Reykjavik and we talked and we had coffee together and I met him a few times when I ran into him on restaurants, etc.
The U.S. didn't give a damn what their opinions were anymore. Their role was over. Now the bomb belonged to the government.
This is.
And then they were shocked. They didn't believe it.
Listen to me. We are going to have a fucking conversation. Right? This cannot be a monologue. He could not tear himself from the topic of the evil nature of the Jews. The evil nature of the United States or the evil nature of nuclear power, he talked about this relentlessly, and you really couldn't pull him out of that discussion. It was not just that he was talking about it. It was also the obsessive, compulsive nature of the discussion. The relentless nature of it.
I don't see how fucked up the world is. That's a form of insanity.
The last time I ran into him, I turned him away from my table because I had gotten enough of him. Most of us think within relatively narrow boundaries, but occasional individuals manage to get outside of the box. Those are the people who make new discoveries, those are the creative people. But occasionally, it is difficult to get back into the box.
Making rules takes the queen.
His genius.
So stick a knife here.
And his illness, I joined at the hip. I don't think that Bobby could have been as creative, as extraordinary, without being extraordinary in other aspects. And that aspect we call a disease.
So the whole game is collapsing, yeah, it's very sad.
I don't consider myself to be a genius at chess. I consider myself more to be a genius who just happens to play chess. Understand? So I could be doing any... I could have done and I can do any number of other things, you know? You know, I always wanted to write some song. I was telling Evans, Larry Evans, was back in the 60s, I remember, saying, you know, I listened to all these songs and I wish I could write that, but I try to write something, I try to think of something, and I just, nothing comes out. And he says, yeah, because you haven't lived. He says, I started thinking about it. He's right.
All my other life, I've written the library, all my personal correspondence, all my chess desk,
he died from a psychiatric illness. He did not want to accept treatment for benign prostatic hypertrophy.
He refused dialysis, I understand. Probably could have prolonged his life if he'd taken it.
I was able to get him a photograph of Regina and Joan Baez with him, which is what he had with him in the hospital when he died.
Reportedly, Fischer's last words were, "Nothing is so healing as the human touch."
Eight. I am in vacancy covering the Tata tournament, and then Bobby has died a few hours ago, and my boss calls me and asks me a lot of articles and things like that. I have to write a lot of things. And then I think, okay, I am here surrounded by many top grandmasters. Let's ask them their opinion on Fischer. And then the first one I meet was Carlsen, who at that moment was probably 17 years old. And then at 17 years old, he tells me this sentence. I don't know if you agree, but I think that this sentence is a genius describing what a genius is. Somebody who has the ability to make look easy what is actually very difficult. You know, fortunately, Fischer's games are there, and that collection includes several pieces of art. For instance, one question for you. How many of you know Donald Birne Fischer 1956, when he was 13 years old? Very few of you. Oh my God. Ah, okay. If you are a chess amateur and you still don't know this game, please, after the lecture, go quickly to your room and look at it. Most important contribution from Fischer. But don't forget about how the very talented boys and girls should be educated. I'm sorry for my bad English. Thank you very much.
Leontxo, fantastic, absolutely enthralling and spectacular. I hadn't seen that video footage before as well, to actually not only listen to your words, but then hear Fischer's voice and hear his words, and that really poignant, quite, and I've been to his grave, actually, Leontxo, so I've been to Fischer's grave, as probably some people in this room have as well. Just a quick story from me, and then throw it open to anyone from the floor. There's probably some people got questions here, if that's okay. We, of course, Boris Spassky played a big part in what you just said, and a big part of Boris's life. They were great friends, as we know, as you as know better than I, I'm sure. But Boris was here. Boris Spassky has been a guest at this tournament twice, and on one occasion, the quick thing I'm going to say now, late one evening at the bar, I was there with Boris, and I think Ivan Sokolov was there, Bosnian grandmaster, and maybe one or two other people just sort of watching or listening. And anyway, talking about Bobby. I don't know if you know this story, Leontxo. Anyway, talking about Bobby Fischer, who died, Bobby had died that year, I think, or maybe the year before. And suddenly, Boris, sort of in the middle of this conversation, we've had a few wines, he takes out his wallet, like this, and he takes out of his wallet a photograph, like a passport, a little sort of personal snapshot, a couple of private photos of Bobby from a party, from a time that the sort of a secret trip that Boris had taken to Reykjavik to meet with Bobby, which hadn't received any publicity, and he was carrying around in his wallet a couple of photographs of Bobby Fischer, like it was his brother or a relative that he'd lost. And it was very sad, and again, I used the word poignant, it was amazing. That just came out in conversation. He showed us, hey, look at these pictures, look at these pictures. And Ivan was there, and I was, it was amazing. So, quite a powerful memory for me. And that happened here in Gibraltar, at the bar, here in the Caleta. Okay, just wanted to share that. So, anyone here from the floor would like to ask a question about anything? I'm very interested. I read an article by Larry Evans quite a while ago about referring to Bobby Fischer's book collection.
Yes.
And there are some books by Friedrich Rankin called Openings Ancient and Modern. They go back 100 years ago. They were a forerunner of MCO. And Bobby Fischer was very, very keen on Friedrich Rankin, Openings Ancient and Modern. And Larry Evans said that he noticed that Bobby liked to write loads and loads of notes in the volume he had of Friedrich Rankin. And that's an example of a book that I think would be of great interest, at least of historical interest, even if, much analysis will be old hat, but it would certainly be of great interest. Can you shed any light on what happened to Bobby Fischer's book collection, if you know anything about his Friedrich Rankin book?
What I remember, because he told me that many times, he was very sensitive. He was, one of the biggest traumas he suffered in his life was when the USA Justice took over his collection of books, documents, memorabilia, and so on. He was extremely angry
about this.
Extremely.
Standardly, yes.
I think this is, of course, it's not a way to justify, but it's a way to explain from the pathological point of view why he said such a terrible things about September 11th. Because about 1 or 2 years before that, he suffered that trauma. For him, this collection, his library, his books, and so on, was extremely valuable. Yes.
But I think I read it in some British magazine, and John Saunders can probably tell me what it is. But I read a story that, of course, you talked about Larson, right? And Larson was, when Fischer beat him, he was extremely strong. And 71, in 70, Larson played board one for the rest of the world, because USSR, Fischer played board two.
Yeah.
But apparently Larson had been one of Fischer's seconds at one of the interzonals. Now, which interzonal, I don't remember. Maybe it was a candidate's. But the story goes that when Fischer lost, he would go back to his hotel room and cry. And Larson would read him Tarzan stories. And then it would cheer him up. Do you know anything about this?
I didn't know that, but thank you for telling us this. And this is a confirmation.
I know that story.
What you say is a confirmation of what I said about Fischer being a very big child. This is already a confirmation. It's a nice story.
What Ben told me was that Bobby wasn't well, and he had a cold, and he had the usual thing, you have the towel over your head and you have this steam and trying to recover. But of course that was wasting time. And that was anathema for Bobby. So Bent read to him Tarzan's stories, but at that time Bobby was only 15 years old. I was entitled to read and enjoy Tarzan stories. I certainly did, perhaps a little bit younger than that. That's that story, I think, made clear.
Oh, I see, okay, thank you very much.
She's in the film.
Yes, and I know about her, but I never met her, so I cannot add anything else.
She was the secretary of the Japanese
Yes.
Chess Federation. She was visible in that film towards the end, although in the book, Bobby Fischer Against the World, it isn't mentioned mm-hmm. that the wife was there. I didn't know her in any relationship with Bobby, and probably wouldn't have asked her had I known, because that would have been impinging on private matters.
Mm-hmm.
To see that was amazed by the speed which he was analyzing the games. I mean, he was talking about his IQ, and for instance, he said that he could just see by flicking into the games in 10 seconds, for instance, for 100 games. Is it true or is it a discovery?
Well, definitely I can confirm that he was extremely fast analyzing games. Very often I had to say, Bobby, please, I cannot follow you. And he had to stop when he was showing me some games. Yes. He was analyzing, even without the board, just talking about positions. Very often I was unable to follow him. And I had to ask him to speak slowly, because otherwise it was impossible.
Okay, so it's not a deal.
No, it's completely true, yes.
So can you tell us a few words about that, please?
Sorry.
Can you say something about that? What year is it? Just a little bit.
I am very young in this moment. I don't understand this.
When you were Bobby Fischer,
your memory is on Palma de Mallorca.
Yeah, I remember because somebody said about he lose against Popularse.
Yes.
But he's in Palma de Mallorca, in 1970, international tournament. Mm-hmm. And I am the most for, because I remember in this moment, I am the most for all games. Uh-huh. You know, my English is terrible for you. Okay, and in the first 2 hours, I heard the most for all games, and after somebody helped me, no? But I remember, I am very impressed with that Sigoy Fischer, no? Very close to me. In this moment, I am international master. No, I am not international master. I am only one good player, but nothing more, no?
But it's an unforgettable memory for you, of course. Yeah.
No, I remember when in the hotel, when Larsen beat Bobby Fischer, right in the ascensor, elevator. Bobby Fischer won, but Larsen is better. I remember this. This is the only thing I remember.
I see.
Yeah.
Yes, people might be rather confused by that. How did Stewart Reuben, a 2200 player, play Bobby Fischer? The answer was, in the United States in the 1960s, you played for money. And what we played for was on even terms in terms of chess, for a dollar. If he won, he got a dollar. If I won, I got $10. That never happened. And we played 9 games, and one of the interesting things about that is it was 2 sessions. The first session, I was able to equalize with the white pieces. And in one of the games, I was even winning. You'll find that game, of course, on Chess Space. And we drew. The second session, I could no longer equalize with the white pieces. He had learnt more from our encounters than I had. And I thought, you know, that was very revealing at the time. But I was rather relieved, I don't know if you believe that as well, that his illness made him mad, and that's why he had those revolting views, because I found that very painful, as I'm sure you did as well, because of course I'm Jewish and he was anti-Jewish.
His outside home, well, very often just to help the Bobby and Joan, because it was a single parent family. So perhaps Regina was forced to do this. But anyway, Bobby had not the best opinion on his mother, probably because of that, and he was very angry about not knowing who his father was until he died. Both of them were Jewish, so perhaps his psychological reaction was against everything related to Jewish. That would be an explanation.
Do you have any idea why his mom...
The old Olafsson, and he is a very interesting person, and he told me a lot of very interesting things on Bobby, and also I don't remember because the Icelandic names are quite complicated, but a man who is inside this documentary, who is the main organizer, who was the main organizer of Reykjavik 72, he had also a lot of memories about that and about Bobby, And the grandmasters, Grandmaster Peterson, McGeir Peterson, as well, and many other people. That's why my two-page story for El País was very successful, because I had a lot of very good statements inside, quotes. Yeah.
Okay, very well, I don't want to answer the prize, unless you've got one. Yeah, do you have a question? Yeah, please, Priscilla.
Thank you. Did Bobby think anything much of the internet? Did he ever use the internet?
No, because when I was talking to him was 1991, 92, 93, so it's too early, yeah. Too early. I think we never...
Larry Evans said, let's look at your German game. I'm there, David Lee is there, and Larry is there. And Bobby said immediately, oh no, because if I win the game, everybody will say, it was Larry Evans won the game. So we looked at each other and went someplace in blackjack elsewhere.